Wow, we have almost solved all challenges of Pwn Adventure 3. Only one challenge, Pirate's Treasure, with 500 points is left. From our Let's Play a long time ago, we also know that there is the pirate ship with a chest. Let's check the boat. Is that a chest as well? I don't trust it. Oh, DLC. Oh, I guess I was wrong with the free-to-play. I guess you have to pay. Unlock. Unlock code entered is not valid. Try again. Okay. I guess we know what we have to do here. And when you try to open it, it asks for a Pirate's Treasure DLC unlock code. So clearly we have to find a valid code or key. So this is probably a Keegan challenge. A quick look into the functions of the libgamelogic library shows that there are functions called submit DLC key. The interesting one is from the player class because it will call the verify key function of the key verifier class. The return value of this function will be in the AL register and through a few indirections eventually checked here. This is where it decides if we print the failure message or are successful. Now, you can simply modify the client here or set a breakpoint and make sure that we pass this check, but this would be way too easy. The client might think it was correct, but the server, which has the same verification code, won't give us access to the chest and thus won't give us the item that is the flag. So we have to look deeper into the verify key function. And that function is not looking super crazy, but it definitely requires some work to go through. So how do we tackle this now? As always with reversing, this already feels overwhelming. There's so much assembler code and we have no clue what's going on. So let's try to be systematic about it and start with a high level view and then work ourselves down the layers. Let's start with a look at the flow graph and see if we can identify some sections that we can kind of isolate from each other. And right at the start, it looks like all this part over here is part of a big loop. And then we have a short contained loop afterwards. After that, a simple check, then another loop, followed by a long sequence of operation which ends in another loop. And if we pass all of this, we set the return value to 1, which means the key was correct. So let's look at the first loop. The loop condition here is a comparison. And shortly before that is a call to get the size of the length of a C++ string. And of course, verify key function will get the unlock code we entered as a string parameter. So this will probably get the size of the key we entered. And the return of the call to size, so the length of the string, will be in RAX and compare to RDI. And RDI is coming from this local variable, which is actually this local variable. And this one was also set to 0 initially. If you look at the block right before it loops back up, you see the same variable being loaded, incremented by 1 and then moved back. So this is clearly a for loop. We have the init, I set to 0. We have the condition, if I is above or equal the size of the string, we exit the loop. So the for loop condition is I smaller than the size of the string. And we have the increment here, which simply increments I. So this loops over our input string. We also know that the string address is passed to the function via RDI. So this local variable here is our input key. And when we look what this loop does, we see that it uses the key and the current I value with the brackets operator. So it accesses the ith element of the string. And this ith character is then compared to hex 20, which is of course the ASCII character space. And the same check is happening for dash. So if it finds a space or dash in the input key, it will skip this whole part and move directly to the I increment. So it ignores those characters. If it was any other character, we have another check here for hex 19. And we see that based on some condition, this value is incremented. So if this check fails, we immediately return from the verify key, which means the key had the wrong format. But if it's correct, it increments another value or counter. So that means this is the number of correct characters. If you look closely at this check, then you see it depends on a function call to this obscured function cfztujej. So we have to look into that one. Remember that this is orange because it is dynamically loaded, so we have to find the actual function implementation via the function search. Here we got it. In here we have a check if the character is a lowercase letter by checking if the current character to check is larger or equal to lowercase a and smaller or equal than lowercase z. If that is the case, we subtract text to zero or space. This is a super cool property of ASCII. If you check the ASCII table, you will notice that the distance of the lowercase to uppercase letters is exactly hex to zero. This means if you want to convert from lower to uppercase or upper to lowercase, you just have to subtract or add hex to zero. So here it makes sure that the input is uppercase by converting lowercase letters. After that is another loop. This local variable is incremented here, so that's probably another I. We then take a character from an offset here from I and compare it to our character we are checking. If we follow this, interpret this as an address, we land here. A string 0123456789ABCD and so forth. But be careful, it's not the full alphabet. ABCDEFG is missing, I is missing, and more. So this for loop loops over these valid characters and checks our input character, and it has to match. One small but very important detail here is that the function takes not only the character to check, but also a char pointer. And at the location of this char pointer, it will also increment a value along the for loop incremented value I. So it will keep incrementing that value until the valid character is found. This might all look pretty complicated, but long story short, if we go back to the key verifier, the first loop here is an input check or validator. It ignores spaces and dashes, but counts and enforces valid characters. And our valid input characters are the numbers and the letters in the alphabet we found. And this one function also helps creating a new array that maps our input to the indices of the alphabet. So for example, the input letter 0 would be found immediately and stay 0, but A would be found after 10 iterations of the loop, so it would store at 10. Makes sense, right? It just maps out the input key to indices of the alphabet. After that, we only work with this new array. Besides that, it also counts the amount of valid characters and compares it to hex 19, which is 25 in decimal. So our input has to be 25 characters long. This means we have understood this part and can move on. On to the next smaller loop. So this is also clearly a for loop. We initialize a value to 0, compare it to the constant hex 18, which is decimal 24, so one less than what we thought was our input length, and then this value is incremented here. So that is I of this for loop. And inside that loop, we take again a value from the offset of I. I assume we get the ith valid input value. Then we also load this other variable, add our character to it, and move the resulting byte back into the other variable. That's all it's doing. And after that, the loop, we load the other variable, apply a binary AND with hex 1F, load another byte into EAX and compare those two. So maybe it's time to set a breakpoint in the code and see what's happening. Our assumption is that if we enter 25 valid characters, we should get to here. We also just assume that this loop simply sums up the first 24 characters indices we have and stores the sum result in this variable. So let's break here. To find this, we can disassemble the verify key function by giving it the full name surrounded by single quotes. GDB should also know tab completion, so that shouldn't be an issue. As you can see, our addresses in GDB are very different from the ones in the disassembler. That's because our library is loaded somewhere into memory. But it's always loaded memory aligned, which means the lower bytes should be constant. So we can look for B98 at the end, and we find this line. We also see it matches the code, compare EAX, EDX, perfect. So let's set a breakpoint there. Then let's enter a string. How about we just enter the first 25 characters of the alphabet and see what happens. We hit the breakpoint and see that hex 14 is compared to hex 18. We know that our loop loops over an array at RBP minus hex 30. So we can look at it. Maybe shown as single bytes instead. Yeah, that looks good. It's the indices of the alphabet from our input. The ASCII character 0 matched to byte 0, and the ASCII character A matched to hex A. So that's 10. It's the 10th character in the alphabet. So now it's clear what the code does. If we now print the memory location from our two values that are compared, so RBP minus hex 41 and RBP minus hex 18, we see that the sum is compared to the last character value, and that's a mismatch. We can also verify that in Python. First, we define the alphabet with our characters, then we loop over the first 24 characters of our test, and our test input was just using the alphabet. And for each character, we then find the offset, the index in this string, and add it to the sum. The result is 276, or in hex 114. The sum is also ended with hex 1f, so the result is hex 14. Exactly what GDB uses to compare the last character, the 25th character. So this is a checksum. This is a simple verification that you didn't mistype the unlock code. The last character of your input is derived from the sum of the first 24 characters. This is our first important milestone. If we try to reverse the Keegan, we know now if we find 24 valid characters, then the last character, the 25th one, is simply the sum of those. Oh, it must be so hard to follow this boring reversing in assembler, but we slowly make progress. So let's do a cut here because we finished the first part.